pool. Okay, so today we start with derivatives. So what is the formal definition of differentiability of a function at a point C? Let's see the definition first, then we see some properties, and using the properties we solve many problems asked in CSIR exam related to derivatives. Okay, so screen is visible, my slide is visible, right?
Slide no is problem. Visible. Is it possible to zoom? Can you please?
It is full screen.
Full screen.
Okay. But okay. Okay. Maybe. Okay. Now is it fine?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. I was keeping it.
Now it's fine.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. okay. So we look at functions from open a comma b to R. Okay, whenever we want to talk about derivative, we look at functions from open interval to R, and we take a point C belongs to open a comma b. Okay, so why we take the interval, open interval, to define the differentiability or derivative of a function? Because like at this point C, we want to talk about right limit and left limit. Okay, so suppose this is my interval open a comma b, and this is my point C. If it is a interval, then I know like I can talk about the right limit. So if it is an interval, then like you can talk about right limit, like you can there will be a many sequences converging from the right. Similarly, there will be many sequences converges from the left. So that is why, like, and this C is an interior point. So to talk about a limit at a point, you need points in both the right side and left side. Okay, if it is like suppose closed interval a comma b, then at the end point you can only talk about right limit. Similarly, if it is like open A close to B, you can talk about only left limit at the end point B. Okay, so to define derivative, we need a left derivative and right derivative. So we'll take the open interval and a point inside it, so that the left derivative and right derivative going to make sense. Okay, first I define what is, maybe we don't need that, let's erase this things. Okay, first let me define what is right derivative. So f prime of c plus, that means that derivative of the function f at the point c, but this plus means that it is a right. Okay, so if you look at the real line, positive numbers are in the right hand side, negative numbers are in the left hand side. Okay, so this plus means that it is a right limit, because positive numbers are on the right side. I mean, this is just a simple way to remember it, nothing. Okay, so then right limit of the function at the point C is defined to be limit h tends to 0 plus f of c plus h minus f of c by h. Okay, and here h tend to 0 plus means that h is approaching 0 from right. Okay, therefore that means that h is approaching 0 from the positive side. Again, like if you take 0, we are approaching 0 from the right side, and we are calculating this quotient. Okay, so similarly we define the left derivative of the function at the point C, limit h tends to 0 minus f of c plus h minus f of c by h. Okay, and we say that for the function f, the derivative at the point C exists if both the left derivative and right derivative exist and they are equal. Okay, so this is just a this is the formal definition of derivative, but like again you have you have many geometric interpretation and physical interpretation of derivative also, so we'll see one by one. Okay, so first we see what is the meaning of derivative, and what is the meaning of derivative is not doesn't exist at a point. Okay, suppose like let's look at a example. So whenever like I suppose maybe I mean all of us might have drive the cycle, right? Like so from our home to some shop, suppose we are going, what we do, we take the cycle and we start pedaling it, so the speed will gradually increase. Then like when we going closer to the shop, we slowly reduce the speed, and like when we reach the shop, the speed of the or velocity of the cycle will be zero when you reach the shop. So once we bought the stuff, then again we gradually increase the velocity to come back to the home, and we reach the home, we gradually reduce the velocity. Okay, so it is a very simple process, but it is sort of smooth. Like I mean, yeah, in a normal day, like we just gradually increase the speed, and like when you know we are close to the shop, you gradually decrease the pedaling speed, so the velocity will decrease. So like, so that is something smooth. Okay, but sometimes if you look at suppose you might have seen some car race, right? Like if you look at car race, sometimes suddenly when they want to overtake somebody, suddenly they will increase the speed. Like suppose they might be driving at the speed 150, already 150 kilometers per hour, but they want to suddenly overtake somebody. Okay, then what they do, they suddenly increase the speed, suddenly the speed is go to 200. Then you can see that there will be a sudden jerk in the car, right? Like if you suddenly increase the speed in the car, there will be some sudden movement, then the car will go, right? Like because there the velocity is not kind of smoothly changing, so there is some shake in the car, right? So that kind of thing we are trying to understand mathematically. Okay, so there something is not smooth. I mean, if you draw the graph of the velocity, then at that particular time when the speed is suddenly changed, at that place you will have discontinuity. The derivative of the velocity function will not exist. Okay, so let's see one. I mean, these are all just some story explaining what is happening if you look at the curve of velocity of a moving car. So we'll see the same through some function also. So we look at f of x equal to x square. If x is less than or equal to 0, I take f of x equal to 100x. If x is greater than or equal to 0. Okay. Suppose this represents velocity of a say a moving car. Okay. Now we take x-axis to be the time. Okay. So what happens? If you look at the curve of x square, it is a very smooth curve. So when you come near the time 0. So for the timing, I assume that there is negative time, there is positive time also. So when you come near 0, what happens is the velocity is slowly decreasing and goes to 0. Okay. So the velocity is slowly decreasing and goes to 0. And so velocity is like the speed. Okay. I suppose everybody know what is acceleration. So acceleration means like, suppose if you have drive a bike or a scooty or something, like so on the right hand side, if you just if you give more acceleration, the vehicle will go fast. If you reduce the acceleration, the vehicle speed will decrease, right? And so that is the acceleration. So velocity is the, if you so this, you know, displacement is the like between two time interval, how much you have covered in that. Suppose between this t1 and t2, how much distance you have covered, that is a displacement. If you differentiate the displacement, you will get a velocity. So that will be a different curve. If you differentiate velocity, you will get acceleration. Okay, so suppose this is the curve of velocity. What is the curve of acceleration? So you have to differentiate it. Okay, if you differentiate x square, well, you will get f of x, so f prime of x equal to 2x, but for x is less than or equal to 0. Okay, so now what happens to the acceleration? If this is the velocity, then if you look at the acceleration, so as x goes to 0, this acceleration also goes to 0. Okay, because 2x, as x tends to 0, 2x goes to 0. So why velocity goes like this? Because acceleration is decreases to 0. Okay, therefore, if this is velocity, then it means that when we reach 0, the acceleration is reached 0. It means that we are not giving any more acceleration. Okay, but now after time 0, we have this curve f of x equal to 100x. Okay, so after 0, suddenly velocity curve is changed to f of x equal to 100x, that curve. Okay, now if you look at the even we don't need 100x, we can just take f of x equal to maybe I'll just take f of x equal to 100x. Okay, so now in the positive part, this is my velocity curve. So now what is the acceleration? So again, if you differentiate this equation of velocity, you'll get f prime of x will be 100. Okay, so acceleration will be suddenly 100. So what happens is, so at all this point, acceleration is 100. Okay, because at all this point, all these places, velocity is f of x equal to 100x. Okay, so what happens is, so the velocity is slowly decreasing. So in this time, you are slowly decreasing the acceleration, and this acceleration is here 0, and suddenly acceleration is, you are putting it 100. So what happens? So you will feel some jerk in the car, right? Like you will feel some uncomfortable in the car, right? So there is, so that means that that smoothness is missing here. Therefore, this function is not differentiable. Okay. So that is that is one of the interpretation. I would like to see the derivative using the acceleration. So yeah, you try to understand this. Like if you understand it, then you know some physical interpretation of derivative also. That's something good thing. Okay. So now let's do derivative mathematically. Okay. So maybe like for the problem, maybe I'll just assume f of x equal to x. Okay, so that is not a problem for even for 100x, the proof, whatever we're going to see, it is the same only. Okay, so now this is f of x equal to x. Still, the function is not going to differentiable. So let's see why. So we have to calculate both the right derivative as well as left derivative. And we claim that, I have calculated everything for f of x equal to 100x. Initially, I did for f of x equal to x, then I changed to f of x equal to 100x. Doesn't matter. As I said, like same argument, whatever f of x equal to, even for arbitrary f of x equal to mx, the argument is same, as long as m is positive. Okay. So we want to calculate. So I claim that for this function, derivative for this curve. Let me draw this curve. For in the negative function like this, in the positive, the function is like this. For this function, the function, you don't need this. For example, for this function, derivative at 0 does not exist. That is what we are claiming. So we claim that if function is exist, if left limit and right limit are equal. Okay, we claim that for this function, left derivative and right derivative does not equal. Okay, let's see. Right derivative, so by definition, limit extends to 0 plus f of 0 plus h minus f of 0 by h. Okay. Note that if you calculating at the point C, then you have to put a C everywhere. Now I'm calculating at the point 0, I have put a 0 here. Okay. Okay. So this is equal to limit has tends to 0 plus f of h minus f of 0 by h. Now we are approaching 0 from positive side because it is 0 plus from the right side. Right side is plus. So if you are approaching 0 from right side, then you have to take f of x equal to 100x because in the positive side, f of x equal to 100x. So we substitute that value. So f of h will be 100 times h minus f of 0 is 0. Okay. By h. Now this h get cancelled. So you get limit h tends to 0 plus 100. That is a constant. So 100. So let's calculate derivative at the point 0, but left derivative. So when you're doing left derivative, so you're approaching 0 from the left side. So if you're approaching 0 from the left side, you will have this curve. So f of x equal to x square that you have to use. So you get okay. So for f of h, I put h square because we are approaching from the left. F of 0 is 0, so we don't need to put. Then by h, this h. So h square by h, you can cancel. You'll get only one h. So h tends to 0 minus h will be 0. Okay. So right derivative is 100, left derivative is 0. They are not equal. Therefore, derivative does not exist. Okay. So you can see, we can see it mathematically also. And like using like a physical interpretation also, like a real life interpretation also, you can see that derivative does not exist for this graph. Okay. So this is left derivative, right derivative is one interpretation. So using this, we can check for many functions derivative exists at the point zero. For example, you'll take this function f of x equal to x square, x less than or equal to zero. Zero if x is greater than or equal to 0. Again, like you can think from the physical interpretation. So what happens is, again, left hand side, this curve, and when you reach 0, you just the velocity is 0. So means that after that, the car is in the rest position. Okay, so because velocity is 0. So in the negative, it is x square. At 0, it reaches 0. After that, velocity is 0. It means that it is not moving at all. After that, this is a like a very smooth transition, right? Because it is coming slowly, smoothly, and at zero it is zero, velocity is zero. After that, it is zero. It is just leave it as it is. So it is fine. So it is, the function is,
sir,
differentiable.
Actually, this function is,
so again, you can
velocity function or displacement function, sir.
This is velocity function. I want to think of it as a velocity function.
Okay, but you are not saying it is a displacement.
No, like you can equally argue, think of it as a displacement, and but you have to give the different argument. See, suppose it is if you want to think of it as a displacement, velocity to explain.
No, actually,
differentiation,
Actually, first derivative with respect to time represent velocity.
Right.
Second derivative with respect to time is acceleration.
No, but first derivative of displacement with respect to
first
time
derivative
is velocity.
Of time, velocity.
If you already, what I'm saying is, I am not considering displacement at all. Forget displacement. I am looking at the curve of velocity. I can draw the directly graph of velocity, right? So for that graph, first derivative will be acceleration. Okay. So instead of look at f, I look at f prime. Directly, I'm looking at a first derivative of f. So if you take, if f is displacement, then f prime will be velocity. Then f double prime will be acceleration. Okay. So here, I am not looking at a displacement at all. I am directly looking at velocity. So this is the curve of velocity. I mean, this is just a way to understand derivative, nothing much. I'm not doing too much rigorous here. Okay. Yeah. So this is velocity. For me, velocity. Okay. Yeah. So equally, you can think of as displacement also, and you can you can give a physical interpretation for the nature of derivative not exists at the point zero, but yeah, velocity was easy for me to explain, so I chose velocity. Yeah. Anyway, so this, for this function, physically also we can see that in the real life also we can see that the function is differentiable at zero, but you can calculate right derivative at left derivative like we did it here. You will see that both of them are zero, therefore f prime of zero exists. Okay. Yeah. Then f of x equal to x square if f x less than or equal to 0, and again x square if f x square greater than or equal to 0. So that is basically f of x equal to x square only. I draw this because so we are gradually decreasing, and then again gradually we are increasing the velocity, like f of x equal to x square. That is a smooth transition, so it is differentiable. Okay. So this is one way of looking at different derivative. So next we look at the derivative from the slope slope perspective. Okay. Yeah. So I took 20 minutes, right? Okay, fine. Let's do. So we take 2 points in a line. For example, this point I take, this is x1 comma y1, this is x2 comma y2. Okay. So look at this line. So we want to define the slope of this line. So slope is defined to be like a tan of the angle made by this line with the x-axis, positive part of x-axis. Okay, so this is positive side of x-axis, and we define the slope of this line to be the tan value of the angle made by this line with the positive side of x-axis. That is what is our our definition of slope. But suppose you have 2 points in this line, okay, x2 y2, x1 y1. Then in school we have seen that the slope of a line passing through 2 points, that is y2 minus y1 by x2 minus x1. Okay, so again, slope of this line can be calculated as tan theta also, or if you know two points in this line, you can say it is y2 minus y1 also. Why? Let's see why it is y2 minus y1 by x2 minus x1 is the slope. These are all related to derivative. Next, we're going to give the this. Next, we're going to see this definition of derivative. So this requires the tangent line, or under the slope of the tangent line. So we are looking at what is the meaning of slope of a straight line. Okay. So now this point is x1, y1. This point is x2, y2. Okay. Therefore, so if you come to the x-axis, this point is x1, because this point is x1 comma y1. Similarly, if you come to the x-axis, if you project this point to the x-axis, you will get x2. Okay. Then distance x2 minus x1 is precisely this distance. Okay. Now, if you project this point to the y-axis, you get this is y2. And if you project this point onto y-axis, you will get y1. And this distance is y2 minus y1. Okay. Now, if this angle is the theta, then I draw a line parallel to x-axis. And this line, this angle is also theta. Okay, because these two lines are parallel. Therefore, this angle is also theta. So what I'm doing is I form this right angle triangle. Okay. And in this right angle triangle, this angle is theta. And this length is x2 minus x1, because this length and this length are equal, because these two lines are, these two lines are parallel lines. Therefore, if you look at this, this length and this length are equal. Therefore, in this right angle triangle, so this is the opposite side. This side is the opposite side. This is the adjacent side. So length of the adjacent side is x2 minus x1. And the length of the opposite side equal to this length. This length is y2 minus y1. Therefore, opposite side is equal to y2 minus y1. Then what is tan theta? Tan theta will be you will have opposite side by adjacent side. So you get y2 minus y1 by x2 minus x1. Okay. So this is another way of looking at the slope, y2 minus y1 by x2 minus x1. Okay, so let's see why we are defining slope to be y2 minus y1 by x2 minus x1. So if I consider this red color line, okay, clearly this has this is making angle bigger than this blue color line, right? So now if you calculate y2 minus y1 by x2 minus x1, you will see that this quantity will be bigger for the red line than the blue color line. Okay, so in some sense, this quantity tell you how much angle each line is making with the positive direction of x-axis. So that is again some little bit of geometrical stuff. But once you know this is the right formula for calculating the slope, we are very much through to do what is derivative. Okay, so let's look at the derivative, another definition of derivative at the point A. So f prime of A is defined to be limit x tends to A f of x minus f of A by x minus A. So you see, like we always take y equal to f of x. So in the y axis we take f of x, like image we take in the f of x. In the x axis we mark the points in the domain. So this looks like y1 minus y2 by x2 minus x1. So basically this represents sort of slope. Let's see what it represents. So I want to talk about slope at this point A. I want to talk about the derivative of this curve. So I have so you consider this blue color curve. Okay, I want to talk about derivative of this function at the point A. Okay, now so I can talk about right derivative as well as left derivative. We look at the first right derivative, then left derivative is similar. Okay, so suppose this is my point x and this is my point A, and so this x is keep moving and come near A, and we are for each x we are calculating this quotient and we look at what is the limit value. So first suppose this is my x, then what will I get? I'll get f of x minus f of a by x minus a. But what is that value? So if you look at this point on this curve, this is a comma f of a, and if you look at this point, this is x comma f of x. Okay, so this is a comma f, this point is a comma f of a, this point is x comma f of x. So in R2, in the two dimensional Euclidean plane, if two points are given, then there will be a unique line passing through that points, right? So I draw the line, unique line that passing through these two points a comma f of a and x comma f of x. Then what is the slope of this line? Then a blue color line, that is precisely f of x minus f of a by x minus a. Okay, so now I change this. So I want to approach a from the right side. So I change this x to this x1. Then this, so the left point a comma f of a is fixed. Instead of x comma f of x, I have x1 comma f of x1. So this is this point. Now if I draw the line joining these two points a comma f of a and x comma f of a, x1 comma f of x1, I'll get this line. Okay, so now for x1 I get the slope of this line. Okay, so what happens is, yeah, this quotient, what it's doing is, as we moving from right side towards a, we are getting the slope of various this kind of this is called secant. Okay, so if it is a tangent, means it touches the curve at only one point and it goes, but if it touches the point in more than one point, it is called secant. Like so we got this line. So you keep coming. What happened to this line? So first this line is like this, then second we get this red color line. So that time when this point, suppose when it comes here, we get more this kind of line. So what happens, this area, you see how much the line going inside the curve, that is keep decreasing. So here it is too much inside the curve, here it is less inside the curve. So when this point reaches to the, when x reaches a at this point, this lines keep changing and it reaches the precisely the tangent of the point, tangent of the curve at the point A. Okay, so what happens is, so at each step you are getting the slope of each of this line at the limiting, when x reaches A, we get the slope of the tangent to the curve at the point A. Okay, so I'm not really drawing a tangent like a tangent, but you might have seen an example of tangent, I suppose. So tangent, like it touches the curve only at that point, in the close, in a small neighborhood around A. Okay, so basically it means that slope derivative is nothing but slope of the tangent to the curve f of x at the point x equal to A. Okay, so that is one interpretation. Like in many interviews they ask for like a geometric interpretation, so you can give this interpretation, it will be very nice. Even some job interview also And like if you want a physical interpretation, like in real life interpretation, you can talk about velocities and stuff. It will be very interesting. Okay, so now do I have some problems related to? Okay, no. Okay, so let's continue with some more problems. Okay, so we look at f of x equal to mod x. So by definition, mod x is if x is positive, then x greater than or equal to 0. If x is negative, for example, if x is minus 1, modulus of minus 1 equal to 1, which is nothing but minus of minus 1. Okay, so if you feed a negative number here, the answer will be minus x. So this is a negative number. When you multiply by minus, you get a positive number. Okay, so mod x equal to this is the definition of mod x. So you calculate the left derivative, you will get the answer minus 1. You calculate the right derivative, so you will get the answer plus 1. Okay, so if the function is differentiable, then the so the tangents, so that maybe I forget to draw one more diagram, but it is fine, we have enough example. Okay, so this this right derivative and the left derivative, they are not equal, therefore derivative at the point 0 does not exist for the function mod x. Like on other simple way of looking at it is, so if you look at the curve, there is some sharpness, so it is not going smooth like this. So if the curve is smooth, then when you draw the tangent line, so the tangent line also like moves very smoothly at each points. Okay, but when the curve is like this, when there is some sharpness, tangent line cannot go past this point very smoothly. That is the one problem. So whenever you have this kind of sharpness, you can just blindly put that the function is not differentiable at that point. Okay, so again, if you look at this curve, left side it is coming very smooth, and suddenly since it's going in f of x equal to 100x, so from left side it's coming smooth, but suddenly it goes like this. So some sort of sharpness is coming here also. That is why the function is not continuous. Sorry, not differentiable at the point 0. Okay. Okay. So mod x is not differentiable at the point 0, and other places it is differentiable because it is just the identity function and it is minus x. So at all the other points it is differentiable. With these examples we need for some other problems, so we come back to those problems later.
Sir, could you just explain me a little bit about that geometrical, when you are explaining the geometrical interpretation of tangents?
Sure, so we'll go back to that.
Yeah, here you are talking about that area here, the area between the
like
curve
region,
and
right?
This region.
Yeah.
So it reduces when I come nearer to the point, means the secants coming nearer to the points, right? Coming to the
right.
Nearer point. To the point. So can I say conversely? See, if I have a tangent, that area must be zero, right? That area between the curve and the that line, because it doesn't intersect at any other points.
See, in a very small neighborhood only it doesn't intersect.
Okay.
Actually, tangent line can intersect the curve in some other place also.
Oh, so I cannot go the converse way, right?
Yeah, correct. What you're saying is correct. So, for maybe what happens is, like, let's assume there is some curve. Okay. So, well, for example, we take the sinus kind of curve. So at this point, the tangent line is clearly x-axis, but it touches other places also. Yeah. I mean, in a small neighborhood around this point, the tangent line won't touch the curve of the function at any other point. That is what we want. Okay. So if you go more closely and there is a neighborhood here at which the tangent line touches the curve only at one point. So that is the definition of tangent line. It is not that it touches the curve only once. No, in a small neighborhood, it touches only once. Yeah. So what you're saying is the converse, you cannot go that way. Yeah.
So in a small neighborhood, if I want to use the integration thing to define the tangent for any curve. So I will take any function and I will use the double integration thing for the, like, on the x-axis I will take a very small neighborhood of a,
right?
And the, so on the y-axis,
right? I understand your question, but like, so basically what is fundamental theorem of calculus? That is what you are coming to ask, right? So that is a reverse process of derivative.
Okay,
so I'll talk about this fundamental theorem of calculus also. Maybe that is the exact reverse process. Okay
sir, thank you.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, but that's a good question actually. Yeah.
Okay, so we'll continue.
Okay, so now so we look at these two different types of lines. Okay, so if you draw a line in xy plane, so it might be like this. Like, it might be like this means it will be like this, or it will be like this. Okay, so suppose if you look at this line, then so I'm looking at any line which is lies in the first and third quarter. So basically lines like this. Oh, what happens? Yeah. Sorry, my writing. So you look at any lines which is staying in between only third and so this is first quarter and this is second quarter and third quarter and fourth quarter. And so if you look at those lines, so then the angle it made with the positive direction of x-axis will be lies between 0 to pi by 2. Okay, and if you look at the tangent of theta varies in this region, you will get tan theta varies from 0 to infinity as theta varies from 0 to pi by 2. So basically x-axis that has slope 0, because the angle it made with itself is 0, therefore tan 0 is 0. So x-axis has slope 0. If you look at y-axis, the angle it made with the x-axis will be 90 degree, therefore tan 90 will be sine 90 by cos 90. So basically 1/0, it is infinity, you can argue like that. So any, if you look at any line in between x-axis and y-axis, then it will have slope varies between 0 to infinity. So now we'll see when this line, any such line, like anything lies between first and third quadrant, can come as a tangent line. Okay, so if the curve goes like this, then the tangent can be, then this line can be tangent. Basically, the line, the curve in a small neighborhood around this point, it should be increasing. Okay, so for example, suppose the function is decreasing. See, this function is decreasing. Then at this point, you cannot have a derivative, you cannot have a tangent line like this. So tangent line will be something that is between second and fourth quarter. Okay, so this is again just one observation only. So but it has a very nice consequence. So if a derivative is positive at all x, then f should be increasing, simply for the reason, if derivative is positive means that tan theta, that the slope is positive. We saw that f prime is the slope of the tangent line, right? So if the slope of the tangent is positive, means that only for lines that is lies between first and third quadrant, that lines will have positive slope. Okay, for the lines here, the slope will be negative. Okay, so this condition means that at every point, the tangent line looks like this. That means that the curve is increasing. Okay, similarly, you can argue for a function with a negative derivative also, that function should be decreasing. Okay, so again, it is just a simple geometric observation only. Because if we know derivative, then we know slope of the tangent. Once you know slope of the tangent, we know how the graph looks like. Once you know how the graph looks like, you can virtually see, you can directly see whether the curve is increasing or not. So if it is increasing, it should go like this. Decreasing, thing means it should go like this and so on. Okay, so let's look at this. This is very, very important, very, very, very interesting and interesting example. So I draw f of x equal to sine x. Okay, at 0, 0, at pi by 2 the value is 1 and sine pi is 0, and like again sine 3 pi by 2 will be minus 1. Okay, this is say minus 1, and so in 0 to pi by 2 the sine function is increasing. Okay, and in the pi by 2 to up to here 3 pi by 2 it is decreasing. Okay, let's see what is happening in its derivative. So derivative of sine x is cos x, right? So cos, if you draw the cos x curve in the same region 0 to 3 by 2, cos 0 is 1, cos pi by 2 is 0, cos pi is minus 1, again cos 3 by 2 is 0. So the graph looks like this. Okay, so now function is increasing and the derivative takes positive value. You see, so this is the values cos x takes here, so everything is above 0, so positive. Now once cos x start to take negative values, so where it takes negative value, minus pi by 2 to 3 pi by 2, sorry, pi by 2 to 3 by 2, cos x takes negative value. That means derivative is negative here. Now you look at the graph of the function, pi by 2 to 3 pi by 2, sine x is decreasing because its derivative is negative. Okay, so that's what it means. If the derivative is positive, then the function is increasing. If the derivative is negative, then the function is decreasing. Okay, so that is again one example explaining the connection between derivative and the function f itself. Okay, so we have two very important theorems. Pretty much every question is regarding derivative will be asked related to mean value theorem only. So assume f is continuous on closed a comma b and differentiable on open a comma b, then there is a point in the open interval a comma b such that f prime of c equal to f of b minus f of a by b minus a. Okay, so again we are not really proving anything. For the proof you can look at principles of mathematical analysis, Walter Rudin. So again, everything in the derivative you can visualize geometrically.
Sir, excuse me, one doubt.
Yeah.
Sir,
yeah,
why please. Is a differentiable on closed interval will not be work as?
I mean, like if it is differentiable in closed interval, then it is there. I mean, we see you are putting more assumption. I'm saying differentiability in open interval is sufficient.
Okay. So closed also we can.
So, I mean, if it is differentiable in the closed interval, then it is differentiable in open interval also. See, that is what I said in the very first when I started the argument, yes, when I started the lecture, I said
interval. We need interval. So that...
If it is a closed interval, then at this end point you can talk about only right derivative and the left derivative. Okay, so
yes, sir. That is, okay.
So that is why we take open interval. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
So let's see. Yes. Sure. Welcome. So let's see why there is a point C belongs to open A comma B such that f prime of C equal to f of B minus f of A by B minus A. See, basically this is a derivative, this is a slope of line joining some points. This is again a slope of line joining, this is slope of the tangent line at the point C for the curve F, right? So, I mean, these two are two geometric objects. So definitely you can see why this is true geometrically. So we are talking about the function in closed a comma b. So we take this is our closed interval a comma b. So under the suppose, see, I'm drawing the graph of the function such a way that I can explain things easily. Okay, so I draw this curve. Now this is my point a comma f of a. This is my point b comma f of b. Then what is this quantity? This is precisely slope of the line joining the points a comma f of a and b comma f of b. Okay, so this quantity is slope of this line. We are claiming that there is a point c such that slope of the tangent to the curve f at that point will have same slope as that of this line l1. So I call this line l1. So at each of these points we draw tangent for the curve. We claim that at some point in the interval open a comma b, slope of the tangent to the curve will be same as the slope of this line L1. That is what this equation means. Okay, because f prime of c is the slope of the tangent to the curve at the point c. Okay, so let's see why this is true. So if I draw the tangent, it at this point it will be looks like this. At this point, derivative tangent will be like this. At this point, tangent will be like this. And it is since it is a differentiable function, tangent going to smoothly going to keep varies. So here from this line to this line, it is changing smoothly. So it means that in between somewhere, the tangent should be parallel to this line. For example, you see, if you draw the tangent at this point, you will see that, tangent will be parallel to this line. So parallel lines have the same slope. Okay. Therefore, since the tangents are changing very smoothly, you can always find a point at which the slope of the tangent at the point will be parallel to the line joining a comma f of a and b comma f of b. That is what the mean value theorem is stating. And if you substitute the value, the immediate corollary of mean value theorem is Rolle's theorem. Okay, yeah. So this L2 and L1 are parallel lines, so they have the same slope. So what is Rolle's theorem? Like, it is continuous and closed a comma b, differentiable and open a comma b, and suppose f of a equal to f of b equal to, do I need a, should I put this is equal to zero also in the statement of Rolle's theorem? Anybody remember the statement? Or I don't need, I think, right?
Yeah, it's totally up to you. It can be any point, either zero.
Yeah, okay. So yeah, any value. Okay. So I assume f of a equal to f of b, then the axis c belongs to open a comma b such that f prime of c equal to zero. So let's see again, it is very simple. So if f of a equal to f of b, then this means that this f of b should be here, right? Because at the point a, whatever the image, that should be the image at the point b also. So what I'm saying is, if f of a equal to f of b, then this should be f of b, because this is f of a and f of b should be same. If f of b is equal to f of a, means that so image of a is f of a, image of b is again f of a. That means that they lie in the same line parallel to x-axis. Okay, so what happens is this line L1 will be parallel to x-axis. Okay, so by the again mean value theorem, you can find a point at which the derivative, at which the tangent line will have a slope equal to this line, but this line has slope zero because this line is parallel to x-axis. X-axis has slope zero, so any line parallel to x-axis has slope zero. From our result, if this line is L1, you can find a point at which the derivative will have the slope value equal to slope of this line. Therefore, derivative will be equal to zero at that point. Okay, or you just substitute a equal to b, f of a equal, so if f of a equal to f of b, then you get f prime of c equal to zero. That is also fine. So this is computationally, but you can visualize geometrically also. So you try to visualize geometrically what happens if f of a equal to f of b in our geometric argument for mean value theorem. Okay, yeah. So so we know now, so now what happens if
this Rolle's theorem can be generalized for any linear function also, like where we take the value of f of a equals to f of b equals to some constant c, right? It can be a zero or it can be constant c in Rolle's theorem.
So you have seen it in a function analysis.
It could be. I'm saying if I take any linear function like px equals to ax equals ax or equals ax plus b. So at some point, if it intersects and either it is equals to p of c, like given.
It is linear means it is already differentiable, right?
Yeah.
So all the hypothesis of Rolle's theorem is satisfied. Therefore, the conclusion is true.
No, I'm saying ki, just here you have taken like f of a equals to f of b equals to either a constant or it's zero, right?
Right.
Yeah. So I right now I'm taking, so exactly that means if I have a function, so that the points f of a or f of b, they lies on a line y equals to c or y equals to zero, right?
Yes. Okay, you are saying they are, okay, you are saying f of okay f of a equal to some x times f of b plus some constant c.
No, I'm saying f of a, suppose you have taken any linear function p x equals to a x plus b, right? Now I'm saying f of a equals to f of b equals to p of c.
But that is again some constant only, right?
Yeah, so but here the difference between, now the points f a and f b are lying at the linear curve p x, right?
No, I have some confusions here. We'll discuss about it at the end of the class.
Okay,
so I have too much stuff to cover, so we'll talk about this question we'll discuss at the end. If it is a very short, immediately I can answer, we discuss immediately, otherwise we postpone to end of the session. Okay, so we take a function f from a to r. So now I take a to be union of intervals, okay? Therefore, I can still talk about the derivative of the functions a, okay? Because if it is a union of intervals, then like near every point, you will have sufficiently lot of points to talk about right derivative and the left derivative, okay? For example, I can take a to be like open 0, 1, union open 2, 3. I can talk about derivative in this kind of intervals also, okay? Okay, so f from a to r, and suppose f prime of x equal to 0 for all x belongs to a, then this implies that, so usually if derivative is 0, then we have seen that it is the function is constant, but that is true only if this set is connected, okay? So if you take arbitrary union of intervals, then this statement is not true, and the derivative 0 implies f is constant only on connected components of a, okay? So let's see an example. So you define a function f from open 0, 1 to open 2, 3 to real numbers. So here I define 1, here I define 2, okay? Then if you calculate the derivative of this function, here the derivative will be 0, zero everywhere, okay? Here also derivative is 0, here also derivative will be 0. The function is not a constant function. Constant function means its range should be singleton set, okay? Therefore, derivative 0 everywhere doesn't mean that function is constant. You can see many CSI problems related to this concept. Like if it is only the function is constant on connected components. See, this is a disconnected set, open 0, 1, union open 2, 3. This is a one connected component, this is one connected component. So using that, there are many problems. So let's see that. I have many problems, so we should see all of them. We'll see one after the other. It's 25, right? Yeah, look at this problem. So f equal to a union e to r2 be differentiable. A is 1 by 2 less than x square plus y square less than 1. And e is x minus 2 the whole square plus y minus 2 whole square less than 1. So df means the derivative of the function f. Which of the following is necessarily true? Suppose the derivative is 0 for all points in the A union E, then F is constant. Suppose derivative is constant for all the points of A, then F is constant. So before, let's try to understand whether this domain is connected or not. So if you draw the set A, you draw the circle of radius half, then you draw the circle of radius 1. Okay, then the points lying between these two circles, that is precisely the set A. And if you look at the set E, it is interior of the circle, center at 2, 2 and half of radius 1 by 2. Okay, so we have to draw that. So at the point 2, 2, so this is 1, 2. I think that place is not sufficient. We are just so this is half 1, 1.5, 2, half 1, 1.5, 2. This is half radius circle. This is 1 radius circle. Let us assume it is circle. I have drawn the circle very badly. Not looks nice. So let's say this is a circle. And then, so this is the point. So this is the point 2, 2, right? So I have taken this is 0, half, 1, 1.5, 2. So again, 0, half, 1, 1.5, 2. So this point is 2, 2. I am drawing a circle of radius half around with the center at the point 2, 2.
Okay.
So like, so it will be like this. So, so this is half radius. Then you you can see that these two sets, and then we are looking at the interior. In so we look at the interior here, and here we are looking at the points lying inside these two between these two circles. So clearly this is a disjoint set, so they are not connected. Okay, but this is my set. This is my A. This is sorry. This is my yeah, this is my A, this is my set E, and each of them are individually connected. Therefore, if a function is constant, sorry, if a function has a derivative 0 everywhere, doesn't mean that it has to be constant. For example, here you can take the function value 2, here you take the function value 1, constant function 1, constant function 2, then the derivative will be 0 everywhere. But the function is not constant. But if it is derivative 0 on A and E, then it is constant because A and E, they are individually connected. Like option 4 is similar, you try to see the answer, okay? So similarly, like this function. So omega subset of Rn be an open set, it is not given an like open disk. If it is open disk, it is connected, but it is an open set. And omega from yeah, if from omega to R be a differentiable function, just that derivative vanishes at every point at omega, then f must be constant. F must be constant on connected components of omega. F of x equal to 0 or 1 for all x belongs to omega, range of f contained in Z. So as I said now, if it is arbitrary open set, it need not be connected. Okay, it may be union of open neighborhoods or union of many connected sets. So if derivative 0 means that f is constant on connected components, only that much we know. Okay. Okay. So let's do some more problems.
Why not the fourth one, sir? Why it is not true for the fourth one? Okay, that can be any irrational number or rational numbers.
Yeah, yeah, we can make it anything. Yeah, yeah. So yeah. As I said, like
actually you said everything about functions from R to R now. This is a function from R to R2 to R2 now.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Huh. For this functions also all the information yeah, yeah, yeah. So, are valid. Derivative from R power n to R power m we didn't define, no?
Yeah, correct. Yes.
That type of thing you teach something, sir, because we have doubts on differentiability on R power n. Yeah, of course, sir.
Okay, okay. So, but what I thought is it is R power n means R is also included. So to eliminate options, to say one example is sufficient. So I thought we will take this example. Yeah.
Oh, okay, okay. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, sir. But my request to take some the basic concepts on derivative from R power n to R power m, sir.
Sure. Yeah, we look at it. Sure. Yeah. Yeah, okay, so let's continue. So this is one problem which is asked repeatedly. So we take I to be two elements set, 1 and 2. For x belongs to R, we define a new function pi of x to be distance between x and distance between this point x to the set I. Okay. So how the distance between a point and a set is defined? So you calculate the distance between this point to every point in the set I, and you take the infimum. Okay. But now this set has only two elements, 1 and 2. So distance between x to the set I is, you calculate the distance between x and 1, and they calculate the distance between x and 2. There are only 2 points, so you don't need an infimum. You can just take the minimum. Whatever the minimum of these two values, that is the function value. Okay, this is the value of pi of x. Okay. This is the value of pi of x. Okay. Now, the options are pi is discontinuous. Somewhere on R, pi is continuous on R, but not differentiable at some point. So we'll see about, so it's basically about continuity and differentiability of this function. So again, we just draw the graph of this function. Then everything is much simpler, okay? So this is the graph of this function. And so these two points are the points on the set, yes. Points on the set I. Suppose this is my X. What is the distance between these two points? Half. The distance between these two points will be 1.5. Okay. Therefore, the least distance will be half. Okay. So the image of this point will be half. So it should be 1/2. Okay. So similarly, if you take any points to this side, then the distance between these points to 1 will be lesser than distance between these points to 2. Okay. So basically, here the function will be, if you take a x here, left hand side, the function will be distance between x comma 1. Okay. And as you go away from 1, the distance is going to be increasing. So the function will be like this, to the left of 2. Sorry, to the left of 1. Now, when you come to 1, the distance is 0. And now, suppose if I take a x here, okay, now still the closer point is 1 is the closest point to x. Still, because the distance is less than 1, this distance is less than half, this distance will be greater than half. Okay. So now for any points here, again, if you are moving away from 1, so the distance will increase. At 3/2, the distance will be again half. Note that the half also, the distance is half. At 3/2 also, the distance is half. So however it is increased, the same way it will increase here also. Now, when you're moving towards 2 from the right side, now for these points, 2 is the closest point. 1 is far away. Okay, so the distance between x to 2 will be less than half. X to 1 will be greater than half. Therefore, we have to take the distance between x to 2 as the distance between the point to the set I. So the distance starts decreasing because we are going towards 2. At 2, we are getting 0. And again, so when you start to go outside, you are taking your x these places, then 2 is the shortest point between 1 and 2, but the distance is going to increase. Okay, so if you draw the curve, you can see that there will be there are 3 sharpness here. Okay, so from that you can conclude that at these points the function is not differentiable and clearly it is a continuous function. Okay, so once you understand the problem, so only at these points the curve maybe fails to be differentiable. So you check whether the function is differentiable at these three points or not. You will see that the function is not differentiable. You can prove mathematically also using the right derivative and left derivative that the derivative is not exist at these three points. Or you can see geometrically there is a sharpness at these points, so therefore the function is not differentiable at these 3 points. Okay, and you can choose the option accordingly. So phi is continuous or but not differentiable only at x equal to 1, 1.5 and 2. So that is precisely the answer. Okay. So similarly, the same problem. Instead of I equal to 1, 2, they have given full interval now in the next year, I suppose. This is 2011 June. This is 2012 June. Okay. So they just changed the set. So similarly, you can draw the graph of the function and you will see that the end points only at 0 and 1, the function will fail to be differentiable. Okay. Yeah, think about this problem. Let me take some water quickly. So we saw that mod x is not differentiable at 0, right? So here also we use the same idea. So whenever this function takes the value 0, this function will not be differentiable. That is the idea. Whenever modulus of some function is given, that function will not be differentiable at the point where this function takes the value 0. Okay, that is the idea. You can check that. You can calculate the left derivative and the right derivative at the points wherever these two functions vanishes. Left derivative and right derivative won't match. Okay, that is the idea. So basically, in this question, they are asking at what points cos x vanishes, at what point sin x vanishes. Okay, so you should remember the curves of cos x and sin x. It is very, very helpful. So many of you might remember at the point where cos x takes the value 0. But even if you forget, if you remember the curve, you can always draw the curve and you can find the points explicitly. So this is the graph of cos x. At the points, at this point, it takes the value 0. These points are precisely 1 times pi by 2, 3 times pi by 2, 5 times pi by 2, minus 1 times pi by 2, minus 3 times pi by 2. So odd times of pi by 2, odd integer times pi by 2, cos x takes the value 0. Therefore, at these points, odd times pi by 2, this function will vanish. Therefore, this function will not differentiable at those points. Similarly, if you look at sine of 2 minus x, we know that sine n pi is 0. Okay. So, this quantity should be equal to 2. This quantity should be equal to n pi. Then, this function will be 0. At that point, f of x will not be differentiable. So when 2 minus x will be equal to n pi, so you substitute this value here, n pi, you substitute here, you will see that sine of minus, maybe I'll write, so sine of 2 minus n pi plus 2, this is equal to sine of minus n pi. Sine is an odd function, so this is minus sine of, sine n pi is 0 for every integer. So minus n is an integer. Therefore, this value is equal to 0. Okay. Therefore, if you take the value n pi plus 2, then this quantity will be 0. So therefore, the function will not differentiable at exactly these two sets. And in the other sets, these two sets does not vanish. Okay. Therefore, these places, the function will be differentiable without any problem. So this is one idea, and using the same idea, you can solve. See, there is a difference. One thing to remember, modulus of cos x only, you can argue like this. But if cos of modulus is given, then you should not look for points where this quantity is 0. For example, this function, cos of mod x minus 5, is differentiable at 5. Okay, even though this function vanishes at the point 5 inside modulus, that doesn't mean that this function is not differentiable at 5. So modulus of cos x, you can argue at the points where the cos x is vanishes, but this requires some different approach. So let's see this problem next. Before this, do I have anything? Okay, so we want to understand cos of mod x that I have done above. Okay, first let's look at cos of pi times mod x. Cos mod x also exactly same. So you calculate the right limit using the L'Hospital rule. You will get the right limit. So right derivative will be zero. Similarly, you calculate the left derivative at zero. You will see that left derivative is also zero. Okay. So simplification is just a straightforward using L'Hospital. So I'm not explaining the arguments. So this function, even though modulus is involved, since it is coming inside cos, this function is differentiable at the point zero. For example, if you look at the graph of this curve, you see it is at the point zero, it is very smooth, cos of mod x. Okay. So similar, but again, instead of cos, if you look at the sine pi mod x, sine mod x also same argument. Right derivative at zero is pi, but the left derivative at zero is minus pi. Okay, therefore this function sine of pi mod x is not differentiable at zero. Okay, so for sine it is not differentiable, but for cos it is differentiable at zero. So from this, can you say for what function f of mod x will be differentiable?
Even functions.
Even functions, precisely. So cos is a even function. So I have given an argument. Suppose f is a function from minus a to a to r. F is, yeah, the function f is differentiable at zero, and f is an even function. That means an f of x equal to f of minus x for all x. Then if you define a new function, g of x equal to f of modulus of x. This function will be, for this function, derivative at zero exists always. You just need the function f should be even. Okay, so you look at the proof. Again, proof is straightforward. So please, I will share the notes. You check the proof. So now with this idea, you can approach this problem. Yeah, so you see, this is cos, this is sine. So what about this function? So you take f of x equal to x, what do we need? F of x equal to x cube you take, and g of x equal to x plus mod x plus 10. Okay. Then x cube is an odd function. Am I saying something wrong here?
No, actually mod x is not differentiable, but mod x square, mod x cube, yeah, mod x power 4 are not differentiable.
So all the powers are differentiable. That what you are saying is correct. So what happens is, so if I take f of x equal to x cube, this is an odd function, right? Okay, I think no problem. Okay, so if you consider f of x equal to mod x, this is not differentiable at zero. If you consider f of x equal to mod x plus 10, this is not differentiable at minus 10. So wherever this function vanishes at that place, it is not differentiable. Now you can check that mod x square, mod x cube, all these higher powers, all of them are differentiable at zero. By using the left derivative, right derivative, you can check. Okay, so there is one minor confusion here. What I have proved is f is even and it is differentiable at zero. Then I proved that f of mod x is, so f is even, f prime of zero exists. This implies f of mod x has a derivative at zero. This is what we proved. But suppose f is odd and f prime of zero exists. So then what happens is f of mod x, sometime it will exist. The derivative of f of mod x at zero, sometime exists, sometime doesn't exist. Okay, we cannot say if it is odd, the derivative does not exist at the point zero, that we cannot say. Okay, so this implies sometime like g prime of zero exists sometime. So many, so some people, like I am running out of time, so I'm writing it later fast. Sometime g prime of x does not exist, so we cannot say anything in particular. So what happens is, if you what we saw is, we sine of mod x, sine is an odd function, but sine of mod x, the derivative at zero doesn't exist, right? But if you look at f of x equal to x cube, this is an odd function. But now if you compose mod x to this function, you will get a mod x cube. Okay, so if you substitute in place of x mod x, you will get mod x cube. This is a differentiable, this function is differentiable at origin. Okay, so for some odd function, if you compose mod x, it is not differentiable at origin. For some odd function, if you compose mod x, it is differentiable. So in general, we cannot say anything. But anyway, mod x cube is differentiable at zero. Therefore, mod x plus 10 cube will be differentiable at the point minus 10. Okay, so.
Sir, what is fourth option, sir?
X equal to zero.
Okay, sir.
Anyway, so with this understanding, we can solve this problem. Okay, anyway, so cos of mod x minus 5 has no problem at 5. Okay, because cos is an even function, so you can compose mod function with that. It is not going to create any problem. Okay, therefore, this is not, at this point, the function will be differentiable at x equal to 5. Okay. Therefore, they are asking at what point it is not differentiable. Therefore, this option is false. At x equal to 3, mod x minus 3 will become 0. Okay. And we saw that sine of mod x is not differentiable at 0. Therefore, we conclude that at this point, f of x is not differentiable. Again, minus 10, when you come to minus 10, we have to look at this function. Mod x is differentiable, mod x cube is differentiable at 0. Therefore, mod x plus 10 whole power 3 is differentiable at minus 10. Okay. And other function, no problem at all at this point. Therefore, like at this point, the function is differentiable. Therefore, option is wrong. So similarly, you can argue like x equal to 0 also. At this point, function will be differentiable. Therefore, option is wrong. Because
sir,
you have mod x plus 4 square.
Mod x plus 4 the whole square can a plus b the whole square. So at the time, mod
okay, okay. There will be one more mod x.
There will be eight times mod x.
Correct. Right. Yeah. So I have to, sorry, what you are saying is correct. So mod x plus
sir,
4.
Sir, we can solve this problem very easy manner, sir.
A series expansion.
Simple manner start. Also we can solve this. Sir. Okay.
So when we write cos,
let me just finish it.
Yeah, yo.
No, let me just tell this once again. So mod x plus 4 the whole square, this is the series expansion. This is the expansion, so there is a mod x. So this mod x may create problem at 0. Okay. So therefore, at this x equal to 0, function is not differentiable. So what are you saying?
So actually, cos of mod x is always differentiable, because we know the power series expansion for cos x. Cos right. x is one minus x square plus 2 factorial. Plus x power 4 by 4 factorial, etc. Okay. If we replace right. x by mod x, so you will get 1 minus mod x whole square by 2 factorial plus mod x whole power 4 by 4 factorial. So here everything is differentiable. 1 is differentiable, mod x square is differentiable, mod x power 4 is differentiable. So that sum is differentiable.
So the same argument work for sine of mod x also, right?
No. So same argument will not work for sine of mod x.
It will work it, sir.
Because of the constant.
No, sir. Because sine x is odd function.
You have a x term.
mod x term will come. So that will like create a problem.
I will just tell one thing. Please listen. There is a difference between concept and perception, I think. Anyway, like, so there is only one slight flaw in your argument. You are saying each of them are differentiable. So when you sum, the sum is differentiable. That is your argument, right?
Yes, sir.
But you are summing infinitely many things. So that requires proof.
Oh.
So why infinite? Like when you go to power series and all, it is very tricky. Each of them is differentiable. Doesn't mean that the if when you sum them, it is differentiable. That is the problem. Okay.
In general, that's not true.
But, compared to writing series, whatever you told, that is easy, sir. Compared to writing series and those things.
Yeah, but see, as far as exam is concerned, I mean, you can take this argument also. So this is the cos series expansion. So you can just substitute cos of mod x, substitute mod x. So you get 1 minus mod x square by 2 factorial plus mod x power 4 by 4 factorial plus etc. Now each of these functions are differentiable. Because you have mod x square, mod x power 4, I told that mod x, all the higher powers are differentiable at 0. Therefore, everything is differentiable. Therefore, this is differentiable. That is not rigorous. But in the beginning, when the calculus, like when the calculus was invented, like very much they were doing the other way only. Okay, so it is not rigorous, but it is still something you can use it in the exam. But you should always use it with a pinch of salt. Like, you make sure that you're not making any mistakes. Okay. Yeah. Okay, this is okay. But the best argument is to use the limit. Okay. Like, mod x is not differentiable to zero. Use it. That is much better. Okay. Yeah.
Thanks.
So we'll move. Yeah. Sure. Yeah. What is this curve? I forgot what is this card. Okay, this is graph of some cost.
It's minus of
cost. This is minus of cos x.
Oh, it could be. It could. It is actually x square.
For some reason, I put this curve. I don't know why. Okay, fine. Let's move on. Yeah. So. Well, let's come back to this problem. Yeah, okay, let's do this problem. So let f be a twice, differentiable function r. Suppose f double prime of x is strictly greater than 0 for all x belongs to r. Okay. Then f of x equal to 0 has exactly two solutions. F of x equal to 0 has a positive solution. If f of 0 equal to 0 and f prime of 0 equal to 0. F of x equal to 0 has no positive solution if f of 0 equal to 0 and f prime of 0 is positive. Yeah, and similarly, one more option. So it is given that double prime is positive. Then first option is f of x equal to 0 has exactly two solutions, right? So, if you remember many examples of graphs, then you can answer this problem easily. So you take f of x equal to e power x and e power x always positive, okay, for whatever x. E power x is greater than 0. If you remember the graph of e power x, it will from minus infinity, e power minus infinity is 0. At 0, it touches 1, then it goes to infinity as extends to infinity. So in particular, it never touches the x-axis, the graph of e power x. Okay. Therefore, you can take f of x equal to e power x. Its second derivative will be again e power x, which is positive. But f of x equal to e power x, this e power x has no root in e power x, since e power x is always positive. Similarly, you can consider f of x equal to x square plus 1 also. Its second derivative will be 1, which is positive, which has no root in R. Okay, the roots are plus or minus. Okay, so we can argue similarly options 2 and 3. Second option, let's say why second option is false. Okay, f of x equal to 0 has a positive solution. if f of 0 equal to 0 and f prime of 0 equal to 0, okay? Suppose a, which point I want to take, let me erase the graph of e power x for a moment. It is creating a bit confusing. Okay, so suppose you consider this point alpha. Suppose now this alpha is a positive root, okay? Function f of 0 is 0. This means that the graph of the function passes through this point, 0, 0. And suppose alpha is a positive root, then function should pass through this point also. What does it mean? That means that the curve should go somewhere up here and come back here, or the curve should somewhere go here and come back again here. So in particular, like in between, by Rolle's theorem, like maybe let me not explain geometrically, let's just go mathematically. Suppose there is a positive root alpha, then f of 0 equal to 0 equal to f of alpha equal to 0, correct? So this implies f prime of c equal to 0 for some c belongs to open 0 comma alpha. Suppose there is a positive root for the function f, then f of 0 equal to 0, f of alpha is also equal to 0. So by Rolle's theorem, we have in the interval open 0 comma alpha, you will have a f prime of c will be 0. So I mark this point as c. Okay, now f prime of 0 equal to 0 and f prime of c equal to 0. Now if you apply Rolle's theorem for derivative, you can find a point in open 0 comma c where double derivative will vanish. Okay, therefore, but that contradicts the confusion hypothesis, because f double prime is positive always. Okay, so let me write it. So this implies f prime of c equal to 0. So this implies f of 0 equal to f prime of 0 equal to 0. This is f prime of c is also 0. This implies there exists some d belongs to open 0 comma c, such that f double prime of d equal to 0, contradiction to f double prime is positive. Okay, therefore option 2 is false. So already we saw this is false. So if f of x equal to 0 has no, so f of x equal to 0 has no positive solution, if f of 0 equal to 0 and f prime of 0 is greater than 0, let's see whether this option is true. Actually, what we just saw, we assumed that suppose there is a positive root, then we get a contradiction. Therefore, we just proved that f of x has no positive root if f of 0 equal to 0 and f prime of 0 is positive.
But f dash is 0.
Okay.
Here the derivative equal to 0 nu kuduthukanga
illaya. Right. Right. Here the hypothesis is different. Where is my argument for option 3?
We can use a counter example, f of x is equal to minus x square, where f dash of 0 is equal to 0 and it doesn't have any positive root either.
I have some example for option 4. Like you are giving a counter example for which option?
Option 3.
First, let us see fourth option, sir. Then we can conclude with the third option.
Okay. Just only. You cannot say all the options are.
It's actually. Right? Okay. This is possible given f dash of x is greater than 0. No. F dash of x is greater than 0 means. First derivative of f double dash of x greater than 0 means d by dx of f dash of x greater than 0.
Right. So f prime is increasing. That's what you're saying, right?
Suppose I assume d by dx of f dash of x is equal to something. I am asking to some function g of x. So this is one differential equation, first order differential equation. So
I think,
if we solve,
what you're saying is correct. That we can do, but I think that is too much work. This is a much simpler argument is there. Basically, we want to do geometrically. Yeah. So because in the it is a part B. See, you see, it is a part B problem. You cannot spend more than 1 or 2 minutes.
Okay.
But I understand your argument. But the solving equation, again, you have to solve a quadratic equation. And you have to write the solution. And you have to look at the graph again. So it is a little bit too much.
Geometrically, we can say that, sir, f is increasing, f dash of 0 is equal to 0. I can say in neighborhood of 0, it is greater than 0, right? It is in the neighborhood of 0, it is positive, right?
Right. True.
So, that we cannot do, like, it can be happen.
Okay, means so, I prepared two arguments. I'll tell you the second argument. So we go to the, we say what is a convex function, okay? So, if you look at the graph, f of x is equal to x square, it is a convex function. So, convex means that if you take two points, above the curve, and if you look at the line joining those two points, it should again stay above the curve. Okay, for example, the graph of f of x equal to x square. So f of x equal to x square is a convex function. Because if you draw the curve and if you take two points above the curve and if you draw the line joining those two points, it is always stay above the curve. Okay. And for an example of a non-convex function, so we draw this function, okay? And so now you take two points here. These two, let's draw it like this. And if you draw the line joining these two points, it is not staying entirely above the curve f of x, okay? So this function is not convex. So convex means that the area above the curve is a convex set. A set is convex if you take two points, the line joining two points should be inside that set again. The full line should be there. But here, the area above the curve is this full region. Okay. So if I take a point here and I take a point here, if I draw the line joining these two points, then this it is going outside the set. Okay. Therefore, this function is not convex. So one result from
here the solution is to be positive. They are giving the argument the third and fourth option as has no positive solution.
Right. So how to conclude? So what I'm saying is if double test is positive, then the function is a convex function.
Yes.
So convex function means
derivative positive means is increasing function, am I right?
Yeah. If the derivative is positive, it is increasing. But increasing if the double function. Derivative is positive, then the f derivative is increasing. In other words, the function is a convex function. Anyway, so if f of 0 is 0 and the function is a convex function. F of 0 is 0 and the function is a convex function, then it cannot have another 0, because if it has another positive 0, then what happens? The graph has to come back, right? No, it can have 0. So what I'm doing? Anyway, sorry, I missed this problem.
Actually, first argument I said, no, f double dash of x greater than 0.
Right.
Okay. That means d by dx of f dash of x is greater than 0. Okay. Right. For time being, assume d by dx of f dash of x equal to 0. Okay. So d by dx of f dash of x equal to 0. So from this, right. I can conclude. F dash of x is equal to constant.
Right.
F dash of x is equal to constant means f of x is equal to some constant cx plus some d.
Some linear polynomial.
Right. Right.
So f of x will be of this form. So now we have to use the conditions. Some conditions are given now.
F of 0 equal to 0.
If we use these conditions, then we will get some answers. So I think so, sir. I'm thinking. I'm outside. I'm unable to write it. That's I'm thinking.
No problem.
So in some sort, we get f of x is equal to some ax plus b. When this once again we go back that f dash of x greater than 0, I assumed f double dash of x equal to 0. So f double dash of x greater than 0 means what happens, we need to look into, sir.
Right. Okay, that I will share the solution. No, I will share the solution in the WhatsApp group. That is much better. Let's not waste lot of time. Let's not spend more time on these problems. Okay. Yeah. So okay, let's. Okay. Yeah. So mainly, I want to do this Lipschitz function. So I told you to look at the Lipschitz function. So this is a very important problem. Lipschitz function. So in some places they are putting this yes, some place they are not putting this yes. So let's so this will take just a couple of minutes only, and we'll see. So it is given that modulus of f of x minus f of y is less than or equal to mod x minus y power beta, and beta is positive. Okay, then function is satisfying this condition. And if beta equal to 1, f is differentiable. If beta is greater than 0, f is uniformly continuous. If beta is greater than 1, then f is a constant function. F must be a polynomial. Let's see what is the argument. So first they are saying beta equal to 1. So beta equal to 1 means you basically have this condition only. So you have function satisfies modulus of f of x minus f of y less than or equal to mod x minus y. Okay. And you guys know any example of a function satisfying this condition?
F of x equal to sine x.
Just f of x equal to x.
Okay. Sine x cos x. All those functions are differentiable, but we want some non-differentiable example. So like mod x. This is just a triangle inequality, right? So. So this is just a triangle inequality. So mod x satisfies this condition with a beta equal to 1. Okay, and they are saying f is differentiable. So that is wrong because mod x is not differentiable at 0. And then second option is if beta greater than 0, then f is uniformly continuous. Let's argue that. So now mod f of x minus f of y is less than equal to mod x minus y power beta. Beta is greater than 0. So let epsilon greater than 0 be given. We take delta to be epsilon power 1 by beta. Let's see how it works. So now mod f of x minus f of y less than or equal to mod x minus y power beta. So to prove uniform continuity, we want mod x minus y less than delta implies modulus of f of x minus f of y less than epsilon for all x comma y belongs to R. This is what we want. So that is why we want this is less than epsilon. So that is why I'm calculating mod f of x minus f of y. It is given that mod f of x minus f of y less than or equal to mod x minus y power beta. So now mod x minus y is less than delta. So this is less than or equal to delta power beta. We have this assumption also. Now delta power beta is equal to epsilon. Okay. Therefore, if mod x minus y is less than delta, then mod f of x minus f of y is less than epsilon. And this is true for all x and y. We are not taking any particular x and y. In other words, delta depends only on epsilon. Okay. Delta is a function of epsilon. Therefore, f is uniformly continuous. Okay. Okay, so therefore option, so Lipschitz functions are uniformly continuous. And if beta greater than 1, then f is a constant.
Sir, one more argument, sir. If what about beta negative? What about beta negative?
I'll just tell you.
What will make trouble on the beta negative in this uniformly continuous?
Beta is negative. Where I'm see, you can, so yep, this is a what is the problem if epsilon is sorry, what is the positive
beta negative?
Beta is so beta negative means basically you are getting 1 by x minus beta power beta, and that is positive.
It will not be defined for x. It will not be defined for x equals to y. First of all.
Yeah. Okay. Understood, sir. It is not for x equal to y.
Yeah, it could not be. One reason can be given like that. Maybe another reason.
Okay. Good, sir. Thank you.
So actually, that choice of delta is there now. How you are choosing that delta equal to epsilon power 1 by beta?
So here I have power beta, right? So to adjust, I know that this is, so when I do the calculation, this is what I got. Okay. So, but I want this to be less than epsilon. So there is a power beta extra. So if I take the beta root of epsilon, then this power beta and 1 by beta root get cancelled, right? So that is some general idea.
Modulus of f of x minus f of y. Less than or equal to mod x minus y whole power beta. Next, right, you put less than or equal to epsilon. Okay.
No, why not mod x minus y is less not than delta?
No. My question is mod f of x minus f of y is less than epsilon, so some we have to get.
Right. Correct.
Here given condition is modulus of f of x minus f of y less than or equal to mod x minus y whole power beta.
Correct.
My question is why not epsilon less than or equal to mod x minus y whole power beta?
Epsilon less than or equal to mod
x minus y whole power beta.
I mean, why do you think epsilon is less than or equal to mod x minus beta? But what is the problem? Because we have proved it. No, this is the proof. We proved it. So, I mean, here there is no logical mistake. So, we have proved that mod x minus y power beta less than or equal to epsilon, right? See, to prove uniform continuity, you take an arbitrary epsilon greater than 0 be given. You assume mod x minus y less than delta, then we prove mod f of x minus f of y less than epsilon. So we have this assumption. So mod x minus y power beta, that is given in the problem. Now, since mod x minus y is less than delta, I can replace this value by the bigger value delta. So we get mod x minus y power beta less than or equal to delta power beta. Here we are using beta is positive. I think so. Okay, anyway. So then delta power beta is epsilon. Okay. Yeah. So we claim that if beta is, greater than 1, then f is a constant function. So let's see why. So mod f of x minus f of y less than or equal to mod x minus. All these things are in Rudin, principles of mathematical analysis. Okay. Now we have beta is greater than 1. Okay. So what I can do, I can write this as mod f of x minus f of y by mod x minus y, which is less than or equal to mod x minus y power beta minus 1. Okay, since beta greater than 1, beta minus 1 is this is a positive quantity. That is what we want. So now sort of I want to apply limit in both the sides, limit x tends to y. So this modulus is a continuous function, so we take limit inside less than or equal to, so there is a, you might ask a question like, can I take the, so in general, in the inequality, you cannot take limit, then the inequality may change. Okay, but here we can take inequality. If there is time, I will explain why that is so. Okay, we are in the nice situation. Everything is non-negative. That is one reason. Okay. Now, if this is modulus of f prime of x, this is less than or equal to 0. Since this is a positive number, limit extends to a, this is 0. So we get modulus of f prime of x less than or equal to 0. This place f prime of x equal to 0 for all x. But we are talking about functions in R. R is connected. This in place, f is constant.
So here the limit, here, why does the limit exist on the left side? Why does this limit exist?
The limit extends of the derivative.
No, it isn't given. It doesn't give.
No, that is, so I skipped one step. That is the reason. So it is not given. F is differentiable. His doubt is correct. So this implies modulus of limit extends to y. That is a very good question. Actually, I forget one step. I should say I didn't skip. I forget one step. So this is less than or equal to 0, correct? So I just apply the limit on the right side. This is less than or equal to 0. Now, see, modulus of something is less than or equal to 0 means whatever is here, that should be equal to 0. That is the reason this limit is exist. Okay, maybe still not, you guys, I mean, still not, I think you guys are not convinced. I'll tell you one more reason. So this implies f prime of x equal to 0, this implies f is constant. Maybe I'll just point to the place where you can see the answer. So as I said, like you can, so you remember in the last uniform continuous class, I told that these Lipschitz functions are important. So I told you to check in the YouTube channel, two videos I showed. There are two videos regarding, so actually the same problem I did in the YouTube channel, okay? So there I have explained why this limit is exist, okay? Or in the inequality, why you can take the limit, that I explained using some sequence arguments, okay? So you please check. Okay, so I have some more problems remains, so we continue, okay? See, I mean, the end of the day, like from this class, we are trying to understand how to solve problems, okay? It is not about solving this particular problem correctly. What are some different ways to approach a problem? That is what we try to understand. Then I think pretty much this argument is fine. So you can check the video.
Actually, I was trying to do the proof for the Carruthers book. Like it is a question in the Carruthers book and they want.
Right, it is an exercise, right?
Yeah, in uniform continuity, and then that's the main point I get stuck here. Why it is going to be differentiable when it is not differentiable? Yeah, thank you. I can check it.
No. So you see,
I will check the video that you suggested, right?
Yeah. Please check. Otherwise, you just WhatsApp me. We can discuss. Yeah. So again, this problem is similar. The function f of x equal to a naught plus a1x plus a2 mod x square plus a3 mod x cube is differentiable at x equal to 0 for what values? See, mod x square and mod x cube, they are not going to do any problems. So only mod x is going to create some problem. So you don't want to mod x. So you have to take a1 to be 0. Then this function will be differentiable. Okay, so that is what we were doing. You don't want mod x if you want differentiable 0. So you can argue that way. And this is the last problem we see today, and we stop the lecture with this problem. So let f of x equal to sine x by x if x not equal to 0, 1 if x equal to 0. Okay, then f is discontinuous. I mean, discontinuous at 0. It is a continuous function, but not differentiable. Differentiable only once, differentiable more than once. What is the correct answer? Okay. So clearly for x not equal to 0, sin x is the continuous function, x is a continuous function. And if the functions are defined proper, if there is no problem in the definition, then the quotient of continuous function also continuous. Okay. Only the denominator should not vanish. So for x not equal to 0, this is a continuous function. So we have to check the continuity only at 0. So we know that the limit extends to 0 sin x by x is 1. Okay, you can use L'Hospital rule or some way you can prove it. So therefore, the function is continuous at the point 0 also. Okay, so this function is like if you calculate the left limit, it will be 1. If you calculate the right limit, limit extends to 0 plus sine x by x, that is also 1. Because this is the form 0 by 0. Sine 0 is 0. If you substitute 0 here, you will get 0. So 0 by 0, you can use L'Hospital rule. Sine x, if you differentiate, you will get cos x. If you differentiate x, you will get 1. So cos x by 1, if you substitute 0 for x, you get cos 0, which is 1. So left limit is 1, right limit is 1, and they are equal. Therefore, the function is continuous at the point 0. The main question is about differentiability. Okay, actually, this function is infinitely differentiable. In other words, it is a smooth function. So this function is called a sinc function. Maybe like so engineering mathematics people might have seeing these people, it is in. So when I check, they are using in signal analysis, they used it a lot. So there I found this very interesting argument to prove this function is infinitely differentiable. So we define a function, we define a new function, say f of x to be integral 0 to 1 cos tx dt. I'm integrating with respect to t. Then what is the integration of this function? Integration of cos x will be sin x, so cos t will be sin t, and the coefficient, so this x is a now constant, we are integrating with respect to t, so that x will come below, right? So if you substitute the limit 0 to 1, you get sin x by x. Okay, therefore f of x equal to sin x by x is also equal to sin x by x can also define like this as a integration. F of x equal to integral 0 to 1 cos tx dt. This is another definition of this function. But there is an advantage of defining a function as an integration, because we know how to differentiate under the integral sign. That's where this Leibniz integral rule is coming. So this is a Wikipedia page. So please check what is Leibniz integral rule. So if you have an integration and suppose 2x square to x cube, that kind of integration, then you can differentiate the function, and this is the formula. Please remember the formula of Leibniz integral rule. In many CFR exam, they will give some integration and they will tell you to differentiate it. Okay, so if you remember this rule properly, then you can solve this problem. It is just a matter of substituting it in the formula. Okay, now we want only this formula. So we have in this problem, we want to differentiate integral 0 to 1 cos tx dt. Okay, so this is of the form integral a to b function of x and t dt. We want to differentiate with respect to x. Correct? We want to differentiate with respect to x because we want the differentiation of sin x by x, right? So then this is the formula. So the answer will be integral a to b partial derivative dou by dou x times f of x comma t dt. Okay, therefore this is the first derivative, so the answer will be again an integration that again you can differentiate using again Leibniz rule. Again that answer will be an integration. Okay, for example, this is cos, this will be sine, then again cos, then again sine. So if you, that will keep going. Okay, so for that reason, this function is infinitely differentiable. So in other words, it is differentiable more than once. Okay, so differentiable only once is wrong, continuous but not differentiable is wrong, discontinuous is wrong. Okay, so is this argument is clear? So f of x is a integration. So if you differentiate integration, again you're going to get some similar integration only. Okay, so that again you can differentiate. So that is a second differentiation. Again the answer will be some integration. So again you can differentiate. So once you have some function which is of the form integration, that function you can keep differentiating infinitely many times. Here you have cos x, next time it will be inside integration you will have sin x, again minus cos x, then minus sin x. It will keep going. Only the integrand will keep changing, but you each of these function, again, you can differentiate one more time, and so on. Okay. Therefore, this function is infinitely many times differentiable. Okay. That is our one argument. Okay. Maybe I'll just stop here. I'll share the notes. You can check the other problems that whichever I didn't cover in the lecture. Okay. If you have some doubts, you can ask quickly. We will end the session in 4 minutes. It's 8:26.
Sir.
Hello.
Sir, எல்லா இது ப்ரூஃப் பண்ணும்போதும் நம்ம கண்டினியூஸ் ப்ரூஃப் பண்ணும்போது எப்சிலான் அதாவது எப்சிலான் வச்சு தான் நம்ம வந்து டெல்டா வந்து சூஸ் பண்றோம். நம்மளே தான் அந்த டெல்டா சூஸ் பண்ணிக்கிறோம் சார்.
கரெக்ட்.
அத நம்ம ஏன்னா நம்மளுக்கு வந்து இது வந்து லெஸ் தென் எப்சிலான் வரணுன்றதுக்காண்டி நம்ம அந்த டெல்டாவை அந்த மாதிரி சூஸ் பண்ணிக்கிறோம். இப்போ ஒருவேளை அது வந்து எதுக்கு நம்ம வரணும் காண்டி சூஸ் பண்ணோம், ஒருவேளை நம்ம வந்து அது மாத்தி எடுத்தோம் அப்படின்னா அது வந்து நம்மளுக்கு கண்டிஷன் சாட்டிஸ்ஃபை ஆகாது.
ஆமா,
லெஸ் தென் எப்சிலான் எதுனாலும் வர, அது எதுக்கு ஏன் லெஸ் தென் எப்சிலான் வரணும்னு எடுத்தா எல்லா எல்லா ஃபங்க்ஷனுக்குமே நம்ம அப்படி அந்த மாதிரி ஒரு டெல்டா சூஸ் பண்ணிக்கலாம்ல. இல்லாததுக்கும் நம்ம அப்படி ஒரு டெல்டா சூஸ் பண்ணிக்கலாம்ல ஒரு டவுட்.
நம்ம கண்டினியூட்டி கண்டினியூட்டி ஃபர்ஸ்ட் லெக்சர் நீங்க அத அட்டெண்ட் பண்ணீங்களா? ஃபர்ஸ்ட் லெக்சர் கண்டினியூஸ் ஃபங்ஷன் நம்ம பார்த்தோம் இல்லீங்களா? சோ அதுல வந்துட்டு நம்ம அதுல வந்து நம்ம ஒரு ஃபங்ஷன் பார்த்தோம் இல்லீங்க. அதுல வந்து ஃபர்ஸ்ட் எக்ஸாம்பிள் பாத்தீங்கன்னா அதுல நான் ஒரு ஃபங்ஷன் டிஃபைன் பண்ணேன். அது வந்து ஜீரோவை தவிர மிச்ச எல்லா இடத்துலயுமே ஜீரோ. அப்புறம் ஜீரோல மட்டும் இமேஜ் வேல்யூ பாத்தீங்கன்னா ஒன்னு டிஃபைன் பண்ணுவோம் நம்ம. ஓகேங்களா? இப்ப அந்த ஃபங்க்ஷன் எடுத்து பாத்தீங்கன்னா அதுக்கு வந்து ஒரு பர்டிகுலர், ஃபார் எக்ஸாம்பிள் எப்சிலான் வந்து நான் ஒரு ஹாஃப் அப்படின்னு எடுத்தேன்னா எனக்கு இங்க ஜீரோவை சுத்தி டெல்டா எந்த டெல்டா எடுத்தாலுமே அந்த கண்டிஷன் சாட்டிஸ்ஃபை பண்ண முடியாதுன்னு நம்ம ப்ரூஃப் பண்ணோம். ஓகேங்களா? சோ அதனால என்ன தெரியுதுன்னா கண்டினியூஸ் ஃபங்க்ஷன்ஸ்க்கு மட்டும்தான் எந்த ஒரு ஃபார் ஆல் எப்சிலாம்க்கும் என்னால அட்லீஸ்ட் ஒரு டெல்டாவது கண்டுபிடிக்க முடியும். ஓகேங்களா? சோ எல்லா ஃபங்க்ஷனுக்கும் அது ட்ரூ கிடையாது. சி கண்டினியூஸ் ஃபங்க்ஷன் வந்து சம் சென்ஸ் ஸ்பெஷல். ஓகேங்களா? சோ ஆக்சுவலா மேத்தமெட்டிக்ஸ் வந்து அவங்க டெவலப் பண்ணும்போது லைக் இதெல்லாமே இவரு காஷி கேண்டார் அவங்க பண்ண ஒர்க்ல வந்து சி ஒரு கர்வ் கண்டினியூஸ்னா வந்து இப்படி கையெடுக்காம போட முடியும்னு வச்சுக்கோங்களேன். அதை எப்படி நான் வந்து மேத்தமெட்டிக்கலா ப்ரூஃப் பண்றது அப்படின்னு பார்த்தப்ப இப்படி ஒரு எப்சிலான் டெல்டா இப்படின்னு நம்ம வரும்போது அந்த இந்த கண்டிஷனும் கிராஃபை கையெடுக்காம போடுறதுங்கிற வெர்பலா சொல்ற மீனிங்கும் சேமா வருது. ஓகேங்களா? நான் வந்துட்டு அப்ப ஒரு ஃபங்க்ஷன் எக்ஸ் ஸ்கொயர் வந்து கண்டினியூஸா அப்படின்னு கேட்டா ஆமா என்னால கையெடுக்காம போட முடியுது அப்படின்னு சொல்றத விட மேத்தமெட்டிக்கலா நம்ம ரிகரஸா ப்ரூஃப் பண்றதுக்கு ஒரு வழி வேணும். அதுக்குதான் எப்சிலான் டெல்டா. ஓகேங்களா?
வந்து ஜியோமெட்ரிக்கலா பாக்கும்போது இப்போ ஆமா நம்மளால அந்த மாதிரி ஒரு டெல்டா வந்து சூஸ் பண்ண முடியாது
அப்படின்னு.
பட் தியரியில நம்ம ப்ரூஃப்க்கு எழுதும் போது அந்த இடத்துல நம்மளுக்கு வந்து கிராஃபிக்கலா பாக்காம விட்டுட்டோம்னா அந்த இடத்துல ஒரு ஸ்டக்கா பார்க்க முடியாத.
ஐ மீன் நான் வந்து அல்ஜிப்ரால ஒர்க் பண்றேன். நான் பிஹெச்டி பண்ணது அல்ஜிப்ரால, எல்லாமே அல்ஜிப்ரா. நான் ஒர்க் பண்ணது அல்ஜிப்ரால. ஓகேங்களா? ஒர்க் பண்ணிட்டு இருக்கிறது அல்ஜிப்ரால. ஆனா எனக்கு வந்து ரியல் அனாலிசிஸ் வந்து ரொம்ப இஷ்டம். ஏன்னா வந்து நம்ம படம் போட்டே வந்து நிறைய விஷயத்த அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட் பண்ணிக்க முடியும். ஓகேங்களா? சோ உங்களுக்கு இந்த பிக்சர் மட்டும் உங்களுக்கு கரெக்டா புரிஞ்சிருச்சுன்னா உங்களுக்கு வந்து உங்க ஒரு இன்ட்யூஷன் ஒண்ணு இருக்கு இல்லையா, அது வந்து கரெக்டா சொல்லிடும். இல்ல இப்படி நீ டெல்டா எப்சிலாம் எடுத்தீங்கன்னா அதுக்கு வந்து எந்த டெல்டாவும் எக்ஸிஸ்ட் ஆகாது, நம்மளுக்கு ஆட்டோமேட்டிக்கா சொல்லிடும். ஓகேங்களா? ஸோ நான் என்பிஹெச்எம் டிஏஎஃப்ஆர் ஐஏஎஸ்சி எல்லா இடத்துலயும் இன்டர்வியூ கொடுத்தேன். எல்லா இன்டர்வியூலயுமே நான் வந்து என்னோட ஃபேவரட் சப்ஜெக்ட் வந்து ரியல் அனாலிசிஸ் தான் சொன்னேன். ஏன்னா இன்டர்வியூல வந்து நான் ஒரு படத்தை போட்டு நான் அவங்களுக்கு வந்து எக்ஸ்பிளைன் பண்ணும்போது நான் மேத்தமெட்டிக்கலா வந்து என்னோட அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்டிங் எவ்வளவு ஸ்ட்ராங்கா இருக்குன்னு சொல்றது ஈஸி அதுக்காக. ஸோ அதனால ரியல் அனாலிசிஸ் வந்து சம்வாட் கொஞ்சம் பிக்டோரியலா போறனால அது ஒரு நல்ல சப்ஜெக்ட். ஓகேங்களா? ஐ மீன் அல்ஜிப்ராவும் பிக்சர்ஸ் இருக்கு, பட் அது அதை அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட் பண்ண கொஞ்சம் டைம் ஆகும். அனாலிசிஸ் வந்து ஈஸியா அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட் பண்ணிக்கலாம்.
அதை
வச்சு தியரிட்டிக்கலா கொண்டு வந்தாங்க. போல ஃபர்ஸ்ட் பிக்சர்ஸ்ல இருந்து தான் தியரி வந்துச்சு ஓகேங்களா. சோ எல்லாத்துக்குமே பேஸ் வந்து ஃபோரியர் டிரான்ஸ்ஃபார்ம் தான் ஓகேங்களா. சோ ஓகே
சார்,
ஆக்சுவலா இப்போ நம்ம ஒரு பிக்சர் நம்ம போடுறோம்னு வச்சுக்கோங்களேன், நம்மளே வந்து இப்போ ஒரு கண்டினியூஸ் ஃபங்க்ஷனுக்கு நம்ம ஒரு கிராஃப் போடுறோம்னு வச்சுக்கோங்களேன், அது வந்து கண்டிப்பா வந்து கனெக்டடா தான் இருக்கும். Today only I read one information sir, any real sequence is a continuous function. Any real sequence is a continuous function, like that I read. For that I cannot I read that
what
one.
Is the connection?
Any
no, I think there is, what do you mean by every real sequence is a continuous function?
Yes, of course sir.
I think there is some typo or something in that line. That is not correct.
Because if you take 1 by n.
No, actually every real sequence, the definition for the real sequence is actually a function from the set of natural numbers to real. That's why it is going to be connected, because the
it's a continuous function.
Right. Okay.
That's why I'm asking.
Okay, so f from n to r, so every sequence can be thought of as a function from natural number to r. Then in the n, the topology or the metric is a discrete metric. So even if you take the usual distance, I mean the topology will be discrete topology. Therefore, every function will be continuous. Therefore, all the sequences are continuous. Yeah, you can argue.
Today class also we defined a differentiable function in the open interval only.
Right. Correct.
But when we are defining continuous functions also, at the beginning we start with open interval. After the development of metric spaces, we'll define it in a discrete abstract manner.
For example, inverse image of open set is open.
Like that. If we drawing a graph or something, it intuitively telling us it is a function from R to R.
That's
I'm telling, just my opinion.
I understand. That's a good point actually.
Yeah. Can you repeat the question?
But here, if we take the domain is n, the domain is R, so it is exactly now we are not able to define a sequence, because that's the question. Can we define a sequence from having a domain R instead of n? Because then it is going to be uncountable.
But that is not his question. Like he just trying to convey that. To define a differentiation, we need open interval, but the continuity we define it in the arbitrary sets also using the further notions like inverse image of open set is open, but a similar thing you cannot do for a differentiation. That is what he is trying to convey. That is an important point. Yeah, there is no question actually. He just trying to convey that fact.
You can see a function from natural number to R as a continuous function also. That's what I'm telling.
That is the point. That is true, because in the n, if you thought of a topology, it is a discrete topology, so all the functions are continuous. So any other questions? Already we gone past 5 minutes.
Can you repeat the question, that multivariable calculus question, sir? That the differentiation two variable topic.
Did I ask a question in multi?
Sir, before that. Previous. I think
this one.
This question.
Sir,
can you repeat once again shortly?
Okay. So this is the question. Okay, sure. So like from A union E to R two. So A is this set. Like so, you draw the circle of radius half. you draw the circle of radius 1 around the origin, and the area bounded between these two circle is what this set A, and clearly it is connected. Okay, so it is connected. The same region only I have drawn here. Now the second set E is circle. I mean, it is a disc because it is less than. First, see, x minus a1 the whole square plus x y minus a2 the whole square equal to some a's. I mean, a is a bad notation. Some r square. This is the equation of a circle in R2 whose center is a1 comma a2 and the radius is r. Okay. Therefore, if I put less than here, this will. This is the interior points of the circle center at a1 comma a2 of radius r. So this is a interior of a circle. Which circle? Circle center at 2 comma 2. So this is my point 2 comma 2 of radius 1 by 2. So this is radius 1 by 2. So if you try it properly, you will see that these two regions doesn't intersect. Okay. So
sir.
A union is disconnected. Okay, so if it is a disconnected region, then function is constant doesn't mean that it is, so function derivative is vanishing doesn't mean that f is constant, okay? Because we saw okay. that it is a constant only on connected components. So that is the argument. So first option is not true. Second option is true because A is connected. Third option is true because E is connected. Fourth option, like derivative equal to zero for all A union E, then for, yeah, this option is similar, you can argue. You can find it, okay? You can solve okay. it. This is fine?
Okay, okay sir, thank yeah. you, sir. Mm. Because at that time I had a okay. network issue. Thank you, sir.
Sure, okay. Sure, sir, welcome. Yeah. So, if not any other questions, sir, we can end the session.
Sir, excuse me.
Domain is connected components, then repeating that soon, sir.
Sorry, what? Domain is?
Domain is connected to... If
the domain is connected and the derivative is zero for all points, then f is a constant. For example, okay. A is connected. Set of points lying inside these two circles is a connected region. Therefore, option 2 is true. Yeah. Okay. So, please check the Lipschitz function videos, okay? Because there are a couple of videos, but... anyway, there are I forgot to say only one thing. Maybe I will just this. Yeah, everything is in the video on the channel. You can check. So there is some function like if f of x minus f of y is less than or equal to modulus of cos x minus cos y. These kind of problems also ask whether it is any function satisfying these functions are uniformly continuous or not, that you can check in the video. Okay, so let's stop here. If there is
one question, sir, I want to ask at last, just
yeah, please.
Actually, sir, we have a particular sequence of rational numbers. If I want to find a sequence of rational numbers which converges to some point x, then I can easily find out through the floor function. Can we produce a right. sequence of irrational functions also?
Which converges to some another irrational or
some particular point, since by the denseness dense property we try to find out, like, if you have any number alpha, real number alpha, so we can produce a sequence right. of rational numbers. I can give a concrete example of a sequence which converges to alpha. Therefore, I want to.
So
I
remember some techniques, like suppose we take x belongs to R. And suppose x is let's just take x is rational.
Yeah.
X is rational. Then what we can do? You can add some root 2.
Yeah.
Okay. And this is a irrational.
Yeah.
And by n, this will mm-hmm. goes to zero. And what about plus x?
It goes to x, yeah.
So it is sequence of irrationals. Similarly, if x is irrational, then you can take the constant sequence.
Yeah. Okay. This is sequence of irrational.
Yeah.
But yes. Okay. But sir, if this is fine. If x is irrational, if x is irrational, then it is right again. Take, yeah.
You can take the constant sequence.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks. Yeah. Oh, sure. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay. So let's stop the session here. Yeah. Welcome. Okay. So any doubts, you put it in the group. I'll answer. Yeah. Let's stop here.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.